Assalamu alaikum everyone. So we are going to continue with the example which we were doing last time. So just to remind you, we were talking about data collection techniques. Within data collection techniques, there was one which was manual data collection. And then within manual techniques, we can say we said that we can use it for counting as well. And if you are using it for counting, then there can be some disruption in your counting because you have to adjust the counter, you have to reset it, you have to change the paper or do something. Then you have to incorporate breaks in your counting period. So when you are incorporating breaks, so the break can be part of the counting period. So the total counting period has a few minutes of break within it, or the break can be an alternative counting period. And we started solving example in which both the approaches were adopted. Okay, and in this example, what we did was we calculated the first table, this one. Okay, so this was the given data for each lane on each side, and the data was for 12 minutes. So I converted the 12 minutes to 15 minutes counts, and then I filled up the alternative counting periods by taking simple average. Okay, so to convert from 12 to 15 minutes, I took the ratio per minute and multiplied by 15, and for filling up the values in between, I just took simple average. Okay. And then for the first value in the column, the last value in the column, I took the difference of the two consecutive numbers and applied the same difference to the next value. Okay, so we have this. Okay, now this is one part of the question. If I go back, this is the first part of the question where they were asking us to calculate continuous 15 minute counts. Okay, so I converted 12 minutes to 15 minutes, and then I made it continuous when I filled up the gaps using the averages. Now for the second part, okay, first of all, what is the second part? Find out the peak hour volume, and peak hour factor for each direction and for the freeway. Okay, so we have two directions, eastbound and westbound. Every direction has, every highway has two directions, right? So for both of these directions, and what we mean by the freeway? Freeway is a combination of two directions. Freeway is a combination of two directions. So you have to add the values for both the directions to get the values for the freeway. Okay, I will show you how to do it. So first of all, I have taken the values, the 15 minutes continuous counts from here, and I put them in the respective columns here. So I have two columns for eastbound, two columns for westbound. Okay, initially, which are already filled with the numbers which I calculated earlier. Okay, continuous 15 minute counts. Now these numbers are for each lane. They did not ask me to calculate anything for each lane. They asked me to calculate the things for each direction. So for each direction, first of all, I have to add the numbers from both the lanes. And for the freeway, I have to add the numbers for both the directions. Okay, so for example, for the eastbound direction, the first number is 876, which is a combination of lane 1 and lane 2. So 426 plus 450. Second number, 415 to 430, time period, lane 1, 438 plus 463, lane 2, you get the number 901. Then 451 plus 475, 926. 463 plus 469, 932, and so on. So this is the flow for each time period for eastbound. Same thing for westbound, 345 plus 388 gives you 733, 356 plus 401 gives you 757, and so on. Then for the freeway, I have to add both the directions. Okay, so eastbound 876, westbound 733, you add them, you get 1609. Eastbound 901, westbound 757, you add them, you get 1658, and so on. Okay, this is how you calculate the flow. So these are the values for flow. Okay, they are not volumes. They are not volumes. Okay, because each value is for how many minutes? 15 minutes. And volume should be at least for 1 hour. Okay, so I have 15 minutes values. I need to add them to get hourly volume. Now, how many hourly volumes I can have for each direction? How many hourly volumes I can have? Now, you would say the data is taken from 4 to 6 p.m. Okay, so I have an hour 4 to 5, and then I have an hour 5 to 6. Simple, right? But life is not so simple. Okay, and the traffic course is more complicated than life as well. So things are not so simple. So the first hour will be from 4 to 5. The next hour will not start from 5 because I have the data before 5 as well, which is 4:15. The next data point is taken at 4:15. And from 4:15, the hour will complete at 5:15. So do I have the data till 5:15? Yes, I have. So the next hour will be from 4:15 to 5:15. Then the next point of time at which the data is available is 4:30. Then from 4:30, I should have data till 5:30 to complete the hour. So do I have the data till 5:30? Yes, I have. Okay. Then similarly, from 4:45 as well, do I have the data till 5:45? Yes. Then from 5, do I have the data till 6? Yes. Then from 5:15, do I have the data till 6:15? No. So I will stop here. Okay. So I explained this point in the previous chapter as well, that whenever you are talking about annual volume or daily volume or hourly volume, it means you have to come the time period which makes an hour or which makes a day or which makes an year. It doesn't have to start from the first minute of the hour or the day or the year. Okay, so if I ask you to calculate annual volume, you can start from today, from 22nd of October. Okay, but when will you finish? 21st of October next year. Okay, so you don't have to wait for 1st of January. Okay, similarly for hour, you can start from any minute from which the data is available till the remaining 60 periods, till the next 60 periods. Okay, so I can start from 4, 4:15, 4:30 and so on. Okay. So if you want, you have a question? I'm trying to zoom as much as possible. Okay, otherwise you can open the slides yourself. You have the slides, right? In the Teams, I've already uploaded it. Open it in front of you and you'll be on the same slide, okay? It will be much easier for you. Okay, but anyways, this is, I think, let me try if I can zoom in more. Okay, this should be good. Okay, so from 4 to 5, what will be the volume? I will add the numbers from 4 to 5, which have been taken from 4 to 5. So the first number is 876, then 901, then 926, okay, and then 932. Okay, 932 is till 5 p.m. Okay, so I will start to add from 4 and then I will add till 5. So you add these four numbers, you get 3634. Okay. The next hour is 4:15 to 5:15. So I will start adding from the number which is at 4:15 to 4:30. Okay. So 901 plus 926 plus 932 plus 910. You add them, you get 3668. Similarly, from 4:30, you will start from 926 and then so on. Okay. Then you come to westbound. The first volume 3062 is 733 plus 757 plus 779 plus 794. Next value 3118, it will be from 415. So 757, 779, 794, 788. Next value 3118 again. So I start adding from 430, 779, 794, 788, 757, and so on. Okay. For the freeway, again, 609 plus 1658 plus 1705, so 1726, you get 6696. Okay, then next one, 1658, 1705, 1726, 1698, you get 6785, and so on. Okay, so you add four numbers, okay, and which are taken in that hour, and you get the hourly volume. Now, the important point is, first of all, the hour can start from any point or any minute from which the data is available, but it should be available to the remaining 60 minutes, to the next 60 minutes. Okay, so it can start from 4, 4:15, 4:30, but it cannot start from 5:15 because I don't have the data till 6:15. And second point, the data is overlapping. the values which I've added for 4 to 5, some of the values are same from 4:15 to 5:15 as well, right? So from 4 to 5, I've added the first four values, 876, 901, 926, 932. And for 3, 6, 8, I have added the values 901, 926, 932, and 910. So these three values are same for the first column as well as the second column. Okay. So for each direction and the freeway, you have five values of hourly volumes. Okay. Now this was just the initial analysis which I needed to do, but I need to find out first of all the peak volume, then peak hour, and then peak hour factor. First of all, peak volume. What will be the peak volume? I have five values. Peak means the highest one. So the highest one you can see is already highlighted. 3668. The highest value is 3668. So this becomes my peak hour volume. Okay, I'm talking about the eastbound. Okay, eastbound. I will do one by one. So for eastbound, the peak volume is 3668. Now, which one is a peak hour? Peak hour means in which time did you have this volume? What was the time period? Okay, what was, when did this hour start and when did this hour end? So this hour in which we got the 3668 value started at 4:15 and ended at 5:15. So the peak hour is 4:15 to 5:15. 4:15 to 5:15, okay. So the peak hour is 4:15 to 5:15. Peak volume is 3668. Now peak hour factor. I showed you the equation for peak hour factor in the previous class. So peak hour factor is volume of that hour divided by the maximum 15 minutes counts multiplied by 4. Okay, maximum 15 minute count in that hour. Maximum 15 minutes count in that hour. So my hour is 4:15 to 5:15. So I will be looking at the values which I got between 4:15 to 5:15. So the first value was 4:15 to 4:30, 901. Next one, 4:30 to 4:45, 926. Next one, 4:45 to 5, 932. And next one, 910 is from 5 to 5:15. Out of these values, okay, don't look at the whole column now. I'm looking at just these four values, which happened in my peak hour from 4:15 to 5:15 in this case. So the peak value is 932, okay, and the volume is 3668. So everything is now for the peak hour, volume and 15 minutes value for the peak hour. Okay, so the peak hour factor will be 3668 divided by 4 multiplied by the peak value is 932. So how much is the peak hour factor? This will be for the eastbound direction now. For the eastbound direction. How much is it? 0.98. Okay. So the peak hour factors, you may be getting 0.98 something, but the peak hour factor is usually represented up to 2 decimal places. Okay. So if you have values up to 10 decimal places, you round it up to 2 decimal places. Okay. For peak hour factor. Okay. Now you can see I multiplied the denominator by 4. Why by 4? Because it's 15 minutes volume and I am, or let us keep it simple. For the time being, let us keep it simple. I will come back to it when we are calculating the flow rate, the third part. Okay, come to westbound direction. First of all, pick the peak volume. we have some tongue twisters in the course as well. I should be giving an exam for you for the tongue twister as well. Why do I have to go through this trouble alone? Anyways, so the peak volume in the westbound. Now you have two values which are higher than the others and they are same. Okay, if for example I had two values of 2965, no problem. This value is not the peak volume. I don't have any problem. Even if all the other values were same, but you have one unique higher value, that is sufficient. But here in this case, I have two values, both are higher than the others and they are same. Okay, so I have to pick one of them. Okay, because value is same, but their timing is different. The first value is from 4:15 to 5:15, the next one is from 4:30 to 5:30. So I cannot say both of them are peak hours because I have to pick one. Okay, so For eastbound, I picked the value of the timing of the peak hour using the volume, because the volume was higher than the other value. But here I have two, so on the basis of volume, I cannot pick. Then I will look at the flow values which I added to get the volume. Which volume has the highest flow? So 3118 was calculated using these four values: 757, 779, 794, and 788. Okay, out of these four values, the highest one is 794. To calculate 3118, I added these four values: 779, 794, 788, and 757. So in this one, what's the highest one? Again, 794. So for the first value, the highest flow is 794. For the second value, the highest flow is 794. Okay, so 794 is common. Okay, so I have tried to distinguish the peak hour using two criteria. The first criteria was the hour which has the highest volume. There were 2 hours which had the same volume. Then I moved into the each of the flow values which I've added to get the volume, and I saw that the peak flow, the peak 15 minutes flow, is also the same for both the time periods, which is 794. Now, after this point, you can pick any of the peak hour of the highway, because there is no difference. So if you pick 4:15 to 5:15, you are correct. If you pick 4:30 to 5:30, you are correct. Okay. After applying these two criteria, if you cannot distinguish between two different time periods, then you can select any of these time periods. Okay. It doesn't make any difference. Okay, you know, some students were saying that they cannot enter the class lecture, and they were sending me messages on Teams. So that's why I have to check. If somebody sent me a message during the class lecture that I cannot enter, then I have to enter them. Okay, so that's why I cannot open the slide view as well. But then I cannot check. Anyways, so in this case, I can pick 4:15 to 5:15, or I can pick 4:30 to 5:30. In the book, they have picked 4:30 to 5:30. Okay, I don't know, maybe they did eeny miny miny moe and something like this. Okay, so you can pick any of the values, but you will go by the book, which is to pick the value from 4:30 to 5:30. Okay, so for the east westbound direction, they are picking 4:30 to 5:30 as a peak hour. Now we'll calculate the peak hour factor. So peak hour factor will be now for the westbound will be, the volume is 3118 divided by 4 multiplied by the peak flow, which is 794. How much is the peak hour factor? 0.98. 0.9817, 0.98. Okay, this is fine. Okay. Now for the freeway. We'll do the same thing. We have five values here. We pick the highest one. Here there is no problem, no repetition. 6785 is the highest volume, and this is coming from 4:15 to 5:15, and from 4:15 to 5:15, the highest flow is 1726. So the peak hour factor will be for the freeway now. Divided by 4 multiplied by 1726. Okay, what is the peak hour factor now? 0.98. Okay, so you can get the same peak hour factor for both the directions as well as the freeway. Obviously, if you get it the same for both the directions, the freeway is the addition of both directions, right? So if it is same for both directions, it will be the same for the freeway as well. But it can be the same, it can be different as well. Okay, peak hour factor can be the same, can be different as well. Okay, by chance it is same in this case. And again, as I said, you have to round it off to two decimal places. Okay, so we are done with the second part as well. The third part is find out flow rate for each 15 minute counting period. Now, flow rate for each direction, see, directional means each direction. Okay, so I need to find out flow rate for each 15 minute period for both directions. What is flow rate? First of all, we define flow rate as the flow observed for less than 1 hour converted to an equivalent hourly rate. flow observed for less than 1 hour converted to an equivalent hourly rate. In this case, the flow is observed for how many minutes? 15 minutes. Okay. So in order to convert it to equivalent hourly rate, I will multiply it with 4, because 1 hour has 4 intervals of 15 minutes, right? So if you want to convert 15 minutes to 1 hour, you have to multiply by 4. So each value which is given for both directions, I will multiply it with 4. This is very simple. Okay, so each value for 15 minutes is already here. This is for each lane, but I will take these values. Okay, values which are the addition of the two lanes for each direction. Okay, so I will take this column, the total column for eastbound and the total column for westbound, because they didn't say each lane, they said each direction. Okay, so I will take these values. Okay, these values are already taken here. You can see here. Again, you will ask me to zoom. I will zoom. Okay, so since these values are for 15 minutes, I will call them flow. Okay, I think there's a problem with the solution given in the book. They are calling it vehicles per hour, which is wrong. These are not vehicles per hour. You can call them vehicles, but not vehicles per hour. Okay, that's why I'm hiding them. So see, I'm like an angel, hiding others' mistakes. Okay. But I will not do the same thing for you. I will show your mistakes in the class. Anyways, so flow will be in vehicles. You can represent the flow in vehicles, okay, not vehicles per hour, because it's flow, it's not vehicles per hour. Okay, so this is a value for eastbound, the other value is for westbound. And you take each value, multiply by 4. So 876 multiply by 4 will give you 3504, 901 multiply by 4, 3604, and so on. For westbound, 733 multiply by 4, 2932, 757 multiply by 4, 3028, 779 multiply by 4, 3116, okay. So you have the flow and the flow rate for each direction. Few things to note here. First of all, when you convert into flow rate, the volume, the unit becomes meters per hour, because now you have converted to an equivalent hourly rate. Okay, you already multiply by 4, so this value is now for 1 hour. Which 1 hour? It's not the hour from 4 to 5 or so on. If this hour continued, if the flow continued with the same rate from 4:15 to 5, then this would have been the volume. Okay, would have been. It's not the actual volume. Okay, that's why we are calling it flow rate. But the units are vehicles per hour, because we converted to 1 hour. But this is not the actual hour which happened in the video. This is something theoretical. Okay, so the units are vehicles per hour because already converted. But this value, I will not say this value is from 4 to 5. This is flow rate for which time period? 4 to 4:15. Okay. Similarly, this value is flow rate from 4 to 4:15 to 4:30, not 4:15 to 4:30. So this is the rate of vehicle. So the rate which you had from 4 to 4:15 to 4:30, if that continued for the whole hour, then you would observe these vehicles. Okay. So these are the two important points. First of all, the units of flow rate are vehicles per hour. The units of flow are only vehicles. Okay. And the units of, the flow rate is associated with the time period which is less than 1 hour. But if same rate continued for the remaining 60 minutes, then you would have. So it's a theoretical value. It's not the actual volume. Okay. Vehicle per hour doesn't make it into volume. Okay. It's a theoretical value which you would have observed if the same rate continued for 1 hour. Okay. And the last point, I multiplied every value with 4. Why 4? Because the value is taken for 15 minutes. Each value is for 15 minutes. So in 1 hour, I have 4 intervals of 15 minutes, so multiply by 4. If, for example, somebody gives me the value for each minute, then 1 hour, how many minutes I have? 60. So each value will be multiplied by 60. If somebody gave me the value for 10 minutes, so each value is 10 minutes. So in 1 hour, how many 10 minutes interval I have? 6. So each value will be multiplied by 6. Okay. So what you will multiply with to convert into flow rate depends upon the value is given for how many minutes. Okay. So in the end, you have to convert it to per hour. Okay. So the multiplication factor may not be a constant. This is what I wanted to see. Okay. You have a question? No. Okay. So no questions, and we'll move forward. Now we'll move forward to manual speed studies. Manual speed studies. Okay, keep it in mind. So how do you calculate the speed of the car manually? You mark a length of the highway, a segment of the highway. Okay, and you know its distance, or you measure its distance. Okay, that segment of the highway is known as a trap. Okay, a trap. So the length of that trap will be known as trap length. Okay, and so you note down the time to cross this. You note down the time of the car to cross this trap length, and you measure the speed, or you calculate the speed using the upon time. Okay, it's very simple, and you have done it. You have done it, I think. If you are not using the app, then you have done it. So it's a simple method of calculating speed: distance upon time. Measure the distance, mark it on the ground, and when the car crosses the distance, you record the time using the stopwatch. You can do direct measurements of speed as well using handheld or fixed radar, but that will not be a manual study. I mentioned it here because just to complete the topic of speed studies, that we can do it directly as well without the calculation using some radar or using some equipment, but it will not be part of the manual study. So the calculation and the other points we will discuss are for manual studies. Okay. So when you are taking the speed measurements manually, there are two types of errors which happen during your observations. They happen. And the first one is known as parallax, and the second one is the manual operation of the stopwatch. Okay, both of them are known as systematic errors. Okay, so we can our observations can be free from these errors. This is what we mean by systematic errors: the observations which can be omitted from the or which can be cancelled out from the measurements. So, what is parallax? Parallax is the error which happens due to the position of the observer. Parallax happens due to the position of the observer. What is it actually? I will show you in the next slide with an example. Okay, and I will also explain how we can remove parallax through calculation or directly in the observation. Okay, so I will show it to you. Then the next one is manual operation of stopwatch, which creates a random error. Okay, for example, you see that the car is coming towards the starting point of my distance, the distance which I have marked for measuring the time of the car to cross. So you see the car is coming, and maybe you take a fraction of a second to click the stopwatch or to press the button of the stopwatch. That fraction of a second was taken by the car to move further. So either you were late in starting your time, or you may make this correction in your mind that I need half a second or 1 second to start the time. So why not I do it earlier than the point where the car actually reaches the start point. So either you are starting the stopwatch before, or you are starting the stopwatch after the car reaches the start point. And the same thing happens when the car reaches the end point of the distance as well. Okay, manually you cannot time the starting and stopping of the time perfectly with the entry and exit of the vehicle. It is not possible manually. So either you are some time earlier, or you are so you, either you are late or you either you are early. You cannot have exact you cannot operate your stopwatch exactly when that car reaches the start point and the end point. It's not possible manually. Okay, if you put some equipment or you put some device with it and then you do it automatically, then it's fine. But then it will not be a manual study. Okay, it will be through some equipment. So this error, which is created because of your manual operation of the stopwatch. Okay, so now you understand what we mean by manual operation, right? The starting and stopping of the watch, that is manual operation. You are doing it yourself by hand. So this creates a random error. Okay. Now the good thing about random error is, first of all, they cancel out each other. So for few cars you will do it early, for few cars you will do it late. Okay, so in the end when you take the average, the plus minus will cancel out each other. Okay, almost, or they will cancel out to an extent which is ignorable. You can ignore it. Okay, the error will be so minimized that it will become you can ignore it. Okay, secondly, even if you say no, I'm a very honest guy or honest girl and I want to calculate the exact value of this error, you cannot. Random errors cannot be calculated accurately, exactly. Okay, so you have to rely on the theory of randomness, that random errors cancel out each other. So on few observations you will be taking the observation few milliseconds earlier, or maybe a second earlier, or and on other observations you will be a few milliseconds or a second late, and in the end the values will cancel out each other. Okay, so for the manual operation of the stopwatch, we know the error is there, but we cannot calculate the value exactly. But the good thing is the errors happen randomly and they cancel out each other. Okay, now let us talk about the parallax, and I will show it to you with an example. So a speed study is being done manually, and the trap length is fixed as 400 feet. So they are noting down the time of the vehicle to cross a distance of 400 feet on the highway. The observer is in line with the entry of this distance, the entry line of this distance. So wherever this distance started, the observer is exactly in line with that point. Okay. So this is the observer and this is the entry line. Okay. So the 400 feet is from here, this line to this line. Okay. And the observer is exactly in line, parallel with this line, to its observation point. Okay. His distance from the road is 60 feet. His distance from the road is 60 feet. So he is 60 feet away from the road. Okay. You see this distance D1, 60 feet. Distance from the observer from the road. From this distance, when he looks at the exit boundary, his line of sight is making an angle of 60 degrees from the perpendicular line of the observer. So he is here. When he looks at the exit line, he is not looking at an angle zero, right? His line of sight is making an angle. How much is this angle? They are calling it small delta here in the figure, and the value of this small delta is 60 degrees. So 60 degrees is the angle of the line of sight from the perpendicular of the road. Okay, while the observer is looking at the exit boundary. Okay, now this observer records a time of 8.3 seconds for a car to go from the entry to the exit point. Okay, so he sees that a car entered the entry line, he reached the entry line, he started recording the time. And according to him, when the car reached the end point, the exit boundary, the time was showing 8.3 seconds. Okay. So he wants to know the speed of the car. Okay. So it should have been simple. Like I've said, things are not simple. Life is not simple. Traffic is way more complicated than our lives. Okay. So it should have been distance upon time. Distance is 400 feet. Time is 8.3 seconds. You get the speed. Then what is the effect of parallax? Let me show you the effect of parallax here. You see, this is the line of sight. Okay. According to his line of sight, the car would seem in line with the exit boundary when it is at this point because of the angle of inclination of his line of sight. If he was looking at the, for example, he is looking at the entry line directly straight. Okay, his line of sight is looking at the entry point in a straight line. Okay, so when the car reaches the entry point, he can see it exactly, and the car is coinciding with the entry point actually. But when he is looking at the exit line, his eyes would make him feel that the car is at the exit point, but in reality, the car is before the exit point right now. Okay, but since according to this angle, the car and the exit boundary are in the same line, it would seem that the car has crossed the 400 feet. Okay, so the car did not cross the distance D 400 feet. The car has actually crossed a distance of D effective, which is less than D. So 8.3 seconds was not for crossing D, 8.3 seconds for crossing D effective. Okay, so we must get, if you want to know the speed, then distance should be D effective, which has to be divided by time. You will not divide D upon time, you will do D effective upon time. So D is 400 feet, I want to know D effective. So how to find out D effective? So this is for removing parallax through calculation. Okay, so if you see the position of the observer, the entry line and the position of the vehicle, they are making a right angle triangle. Position of the observer, entry line, position of the vehicle when you recorded the time. It's a right angle triangle. In this right angle triangle, the angle is delta. The side opposite to the angle is D effective, and the side with which the angle is made is D1. What is D1? The distance of the observer from the road, 60 feet is given. What is small delta? 60 degrees, the angle of line of sight from the perpendicular. It is also given. You want to know D effective, we will apply tangent delta. Okay, so tangent delta will be D effective upon D1. Now I believe, you know, that if I ask any one of you or if I give you this problem yourself, most of you would do D effective upon D1 for tangent, because D effective is horizontal, D1 is vertical. Okay, but just to refresh your memories, because you know this was, you did it a long time ago, maybe in the last, maybe a few centuries ago. Okay, so D1 is the side with which the angle is being made, and D effective is the side opposite of the angle. Okay, so D1 will be the base, and D effective will be the perpendicular. So tangent delta will be perpendicular upon base. In this case, perpendicular is D effective, the side which is opposite of the angle. Okay, so I've done my duty. Even after that you are having a problem, then obviously you should not be here. So D effective upon D1, okay, will give you tangent delta. So D effective will be D1 into tangent delta. Okay, so D1 is 60 feet and delta is 60 degrees. So you do 60 into tangent of 60, you will get 103.9 feet. So D effective is 103.9 feet. You want to find out the speed, you should do 103.9 upon 8.3. 8.3 is the time, okay, time recorded. So you get the speed 12.51 feet per second. Feet per second. The distance was in feet and the time was in seconds. So this value 12.51 is feet per second. Then you further divide by 1.47 to get what? A speed in miles per hour. So this 1.47 has nothing to do with parallax. It is conversion, okay? So 12.51 was in feet per second and 1.47 to convert the units into miles per hour. Okay, so this is how you remove the parallax through calculation. Find out the angle of your line of sight to the exit boundary and or to whichever line you are making an angle with, and then you apply this to find out D effective and then calculate the speed using D effective. This is removing parallax through calculation. Okay, other methods to remove parallax from the observation itself. First of all, you can use two observers. So one observer will stand in line with the entry point, the other one will stand in line with the exit point. So both observers will not have any angle of inclination for their line of sight. Okay, so one observer will record the time when the car entered the segment and the trap, and the other one will record the time when the car exited the trap, and in the end they will both match their times and they take the difference to find out the time to go from entry to exit. Okay, so one of the methods to remove parallax is use two observers, one in line with the entry point, one in line with the exit point. Both note down the time of the vehicles to enter and exit respectively, and then you match their time, take the difference to find out the time in which the car was crossing the track. Okay, one. Another method, position the observer far from the road. So if you increase distance D1, angle delta will become smaller and smaller. So when angle delta becomes smaller, the effect of parallax will become less and less. Okay, so if you can find a position where the observer can be very far from the road because of angle, because of the small value of the angle delta, the d effective will become almost equal to d1, almost. Okay, so for example, in this case, d was 400, d effective is 103.9. So there is a difference of almost 300 feet. This is not negligible. This is not negligible. But if d is 400 and d effective is 399.9 something, it is negligible. Okay, so if you can position the observer very far from the road, then the effect of parallax can become negligible. Second or the third point to avoid parallax is select d1 to be short as well. Select a shorter d1. In this case, we have selected 400 feet. You can select d to be 100 feet or maybe less than 100 feet. It will remove or minimize the effect of parallax. So there are three things which you can do to minimize the effect of parallax from the observation itself, not by calculation, from the observation itself. First of all, use two observers, one in line with each of the entry and the exit point. Second, position the observer far from the road, so increase the value of d1. Third, select a smaller d value. Trap length should be small. Okay. Then a few things which you have to keep in mind while you are doing the speed studies. Okay, and these are the points which you should keep in mind when you are doing the studies for your term project as well. Okay, so now you have an idea. I keep on mentioning the term project because everything which I am teaching you or everything which you are doing in the term project is being taught in the course itself. So don't feel that what we are doing is something which is unique. No, what you're doing, I'm already teaching you in the class. Sometimes people go in the field and they, you know, keep everything which they have learned in the class in their copies, and their copies are at their homes. Okay, so they do something very out of the context in the field, and then they come back and they say, Dr. We did this. Okay, you have to keep in mind what I'm telling you in the class. You have to note down these things. That's why I keep on referencing it to the term project as well, so you know what you have to do. Okay, so there are some common issues which you may face during speed studies, and you have to take care of them. First of all, avoid measuring the speed of the fastest or the slowest vehicle. Okay, now we are saying the fastest and slowest mean the vehicles which have a much higher speed than the other ones or a much slower speed than the other ones. Okay, so if all the vehicles are between 50 to 80, but you have one vehicle which is traveling at 100 kilometers per hour. So from 100 to the other vehicles which are having around 80, there's nothing, no other value, then you ignore the 100 vehicle per hour speed as well. 100 miles, 100 kilometers per hour speed as well. Same thing for the slowest one as well. Okay, the range, the normal range of the vehicle, the speed is 20 to 50, but there is one vehicle which was traveling at 10 kilometers per hour. So you ignore that one. Okay, obviously, if you keep on ignoring the fastest one and the slowest one, then in the end you will have zero value, right? So I'm not talking about the which is very close to the normal range. Okay, I'm talking about a fastest vehicle where that one vehicle was way faster than any other vehicle in the data, or way slower than any other vehicle in the data. So to detect those vehicles in the field is also easier. Usually the fastest vehicle will go, when it passes you will just hear a sound, right? Zoom. You don't see it, huh? You will be guessing like whether it's a plane or a bird or Superman, huh? I watched too many movies, I tell you. Anyways, so the vehicle which you, now fastest vehicle is never a problem if you are doing it manually. You will not be able to record it manually, okay? It will be so fast. Slowest vehicle, again, you find a vehicle everybody is honking at, that is the slowest one. Huh? Everybody is getting mad at that driver. That is the slowest vehicle. Okay, you ignore that one. Okay, so fastest and slowest is not a problem. Even if you didn't notice it at that time, you came with the data, and then when you calculated the speed, you found this one value is way ahead than the other ones, or is this one value is way below than the other ones, you ignore those values. Okay, because they are exceptional cases, and we don't want to ruin our data, mess up our data using these values. Secondly, where you have platooning of vehicles. What is a platoon? I told you in the previous chapter as well, on the at the end of chapter 5. Platoon is the group of vehicles which pass from one intersection simultaneously together. Okay, so if you are measuring the vehicles very close to the intersection, which you shouldn't do, if you are measuring the speed of the vehicle very close to the intersection, which you shouldn't do. Why? Because closer to the intersection, either the vehicles are stopping or either they have just started. So if you are measuring just before the intersection, all of them are stopping. If you are measuring just after the intersection, all of them are just accelerating. So their speeds will be very slow. So you measure it, you know, after some distance from the intersection. That's why I told you, select a segment of 200 meters at least. At least 200 meters. If it is more than that, fine, no problem. So if you are selecting middle 10 meters or 30 meters of your segment to measure the speed, you are in the middle. So you have almost 100 meters before it, 100 meters after it, before the next intersection. So there is no problem. Okay. Okay. Then whenever you have a platooning of vehicle, okay, then what actually happens? The first driver has a choice to select the speed. Other vehicles are just following it. Especially if there is no chance for them to overtake the driver. If there is no chance for them to overtake that driver, they will be following the driver. So whatever the speed, everybody else will be just slower than that. Okay. So measure it far from the intersection, away from the intersection. And I already took care of the opportunity to overtake the other drivers when I told you select highways which have more than one lane. So if you have more than one lane, you have the opportunity to overtake the other drivers. Okay. And I told you, if you are measuring the speed of the vehicle, then select a time in which the low traffic is very low. You have more than one lane. You don't have to follow any other driver. You can select your own speed. If the other driver comes in front of you, you can overtake him. Okay. So I already took care of the platooning of the vehicle when I told you about the specifications of the highway and the specification of the time when you are taking, when you will take the speed. Okay. For the second phase, when you are taking the speed, take the speed at a time where the volume is very low. So I told you at the start as well, if you want to take the 62 values in the first phase, select a time when the traffic volume is low to take care of this issue. Okay, the third thing is, do not take the speed of the heavy vehicles. Do not take the speed of the heavy vehicles, because heavy vehicles are usually slower than the cars. We want the speed of the normal vehicles. Cars are more and they travel with normal speed. Heavy vehicles are slower. We take the speed of the heavy vehicles only if we are trying to study their behavior. Okay. Only then. We are in our project, we are not studying heavy vehicles specifically. We are just studying the traffic conditions in general. So we will just take the speed of the cars. Don't take the speed of the heavy vehicles. You take the speed of the heavy vehicles if I want to study the movement of trucks or buses, like I told you in the initial slides of this chapter. Or in the previous chapter, I told you, when you want to study the behavior of the heavy vehicles or a specific type of vehicle, then you take their headway and spacing and so on and so forth. Okay. In our case, we don't need vehicles. But these are general considerations. Avoid fastest and slowest vehicle. If you are having a platoon where vehicles do not have the chance to overtake other drivers, then you take the speed of the first driver as the speed of the remaining cars in the platoon. And avoid taking the speed of the heavy vehicles if your study is not targeted specifically for heavy vehicles. Okay. So these things you have to keep in mind when you are doing the speed study for your CUM project. But as I told you, for point B, we have already taken care of this point when I gave you the specifications of the highway and the specification of the time for on which you will take the speed. Now, do you have any questions? Any questions? So I will go with the attendance. Dua Rabi. Anna Muhammad. Muhammad Usama. Amal Abdullah. Muhammad Noman. Muhammad Noman. Ali Muhammad is here. Hakima is there. Zahra Sayyid Ali. was Adil. If I mark your attendance, you can leave. Abdullah Jalibuddin. Abdullah Jalibuddin. Abdul Rahman Ibrahim. Niju Salah. Okay. Noman, I didn't mark you. Okay. Omar Noman, done. Nadine Hussam. Zahra Riyad. Okay. Abu Bakr is here. Zainab is here. Lulba Ibrahim. Mariam Abdul Amir. Mariam Abdul Amir. Majd Bashar. Nasir Hassan. Asil Hassan. Ali Mustafa. Ali Mustafa. Hamad Khalid. Usamuddin. Usamuddin. Latifa Ahmed. Fatma. Zainab Abdali. Zainab Abdulal. Ala Salman. Ala Salman. Okay, Asir is here. Isra Abdul Karim. Okay, Ali Abdul Razak. Elizabeth Ann. Ali Makki. Ibrahim Muhammad. Okay, Ali Makki is not here. Abdullah Usamuddin is not here. Ali Mustafa. Mariam Abdul Amir. Abdullah Jalidudin and Dua Rabi. These people are not here. Okay. Yeah, from section 1. I'm going to section 1 now. Okay. People from section 1, Iman Kamil. And who else? Ibrahim Abdul Isa. Okay, Dana Isa is here. Al Hanouf is here. Khalid Qasim, Huda Hassan, Fatma Ahmed. Huda Hassan. Okay. From section 1, Fatma Ahmed, Abrar Amir, Ahmed Amin. Any of these guys here? Okay, so we are done. Ahmed Amin is here. Okay. Okay, so we are done now. Okay. Assalamu alaikum. See you on Sunday, inshallah.